We'll continue on with our study of 20th century music. We talked about how the public, during the early part of the 1900s, this is true of all the concert halls in Europe and in America, New York and Boston, the big urban centers, they were interested in the composers of the time, which would have been, well, the composers from the past. Mozart, Beethoven were favorites, and Brahms. Brahms had done most of his writing in the mid-1800s, but also some favorites were Tchaikovsky, and we heard Romeo and Juliet, and Mahler, who came for a while to visit Dvorak. These were romantic composers that resisted somewhat the new experimental styles and really took their stake or made their stake in the German romanticism of the time. That would have been Wagner and people like Brahms and Mendelssohn. And so the availability, also a reason why 21st century the composers didn't get as much attention, is because the availability of research enabled people to find a lot of music to perform, to locate scores, and to make music of Bach's time more accessible. Vivaldi, Baroque period, and that music became very popular. And also composers valued the new experimentation, and they explored new techniques and sound almost at the expense of an audience. Popular music and jazz was readily marketed and available for the masses, so the masses didn't really need to hear this music if they were already listening to something that they enjoyed more. For composers in general, the audience was less important than for composers in previous eras. And that's kind of an interesting idea if you think about it. Composers, and you think that the composers are beginning to be funded by arts grants in universities, and you can hear where the you can see where the term ivory tower comes, because these composers worked oftentimes and taught at universities, and oftentimes they had other jobs like engineers, mathematicians. Charles Ives was an insurance salesman. He was a very rich man. He sold insurance, and he devoted his after hours to the writing of experimental music. And a lot of it did catch on later on, because that's the mark of a true great composer, is that he goes through, he pioneers these new techniques, he pioneers these new ideas about creating music, and ignores the audience, ignores who's going to pay him for it, and later on other people pick up on what he's done and improve it, they refine it, and they start doing things and make it more accessible, or make actually able to make money off of it. Now, we wanted to hear a little bit of Stravinsky. I know we heard the opening of it with the high bassoon. Let's talk a little bit, just a little bit about Stravinsky. First of all, he was, as we said, in Paris in the early part of the 20th century, before World War I, and it was a big time. There was lots of money. Orchestras were well-funded and well-attended, and people went to these concerts and these ballets. The finest in high society. And Stravinsky's fame began around 1910 in Paris, and as I said, he composed these three ballet scores for the Ballet Russes. As frequently happens, however, his ballet music had been kept alive mainly through orchestral versions of these three major works. So the ballets, you'll see them infrequently. The Columbia Ballet puts on the writers, I think they put it on once. Not like the Nutcracker, the Tchaikovsky's ballet comes around just about every year. But this one is a major work in the concert hall, so the orchestras play their version of it without the ballet. And each of his ballets became classic, a classic of the 20th century symphonic repertoire. Now here's some of the contributions that Stravinsky made. His rhythmic imagination and complexity. Now I have, see if my piano's working here. one of the things that he did was he shifted regular metric pulses. Dum 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 dum, which would have been great for ballet, because you can dance to it and you can feel the regular pulses and the accents. Well, he shifted that to irregular beats, and he also used polytonality. Here's a typical chord. Do, mi, si. Sounds very harmonious, but what happens if you take that chord and superimpose another triad? And the other triad would be, you've got two triads. You've got this one. Actually, that's a quadrat. That has a seventh in it. And you've got this one. And what happens if we put that to a beat that goes like this? That's very remarkable right there. That's exactly what he did. And you'll hear that in his ballet, The Rite of Spring. If you recall in the last lecture, spring has come. The plains are awakening. The tribal impulses, worship of the deity, or whoever that is. Bass clarinet. Little fragments of ideas, images. Slowing down. Now this is the introduction, and you do hear flutes, and I don't have the flute hooked up here. Let me see if I can get a stringed instrument. Let me see if I can find woodwinds of some kind. So you hear this fragmented sound of these melodies that are not traditional melodies at all. They're rather small, narrow in range. And there's a tenor sax. Let's see if I can find a flute. Let's do the clarinet. Those type of chromatic melodies that are fragmented, and then every now and then you'll have. Some type of fleeting fragment. Let's listen some more, as I'm not doing a great job with that. There we go. Bum, bum, ba-dum. Building up. Muted trumpet. And of course. The opening theme. You'll hear the pizzicato on the string, picking the string. Bum, 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 bum. Bum, 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 bum. Mm-hmm. comes in here. Bum 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 bum, just four notes. Drum change. French horn call. These melodies are short. Some of them are very tonal, though. They're not too outlandish. Most of them very rhythmic. And so, when you look down over here, and you see the dry erase board, what I've written, emphasis on timbre and rhythm rather than melody and harmony. We do hear melody and harmony. Not really harmony in the traditional sense, but the melody, you do hear fragmented short spurts of melodies. And they're put together crossing through the instruments of the orchestra. And a lot of timbre, the sounds of the orchestra are really highlighted here, and especially the woodwind section. And then you have that irregular rhythm that we talked about in the polytonal chords, one with the E natural and the E flat triad juxtaposed on top of each other, creating polytonality. So this was definitely, this was a real, this caused quite a stir in the theater when it was presented. When it premiered, there was actually a riot in 1914, and the people that wanted to hear it turned around and shh. People that didn't want, they booed and hissed. Next thing you know, the fist fights broke out. So we had a real revolution during the premiere of this piece. And we'll talk later about some other 21st century developments.